The one word I would use to describe Lisa Leslie is winner.
Superwoman.
Passionate.
Tall.
She's truly phenomenal.
She sets a great example for all women that play basketball.
What is a WNBA player? The definition should be a picture of Lisa Leslie. Lisa Leslie.
What's good, homies? Welcome back. Bringing you a video, of course, about one of the greatest WNBA players to ever step foot in the game, Lisa Leslie. Model, Olympian, WNBA champion, forever cemented in black history, culture. She'll forever be in the culture. I mean, when you think about black, when you think about black basketball, female legends, you're gonna think Lisa Leslie, just, no doubt. It's nostalgic, noir, and we don't get popping with it. Lisa Leslie was born in 1972, July 7th, Compton, California, over there where Bloods and Crips originate. Her mother, Christina Leslie, she was a mail carrier in Compton, so she delivered mail. Her mother made honest work, you know. She was also a truck driver, so when her mother was away, Lisa had to stay with other relatives while her mother was away. You know, and this is at a young age also. While she was living with her other relatives or so, she also had to care for her baby sister Tiffany. So she was, you know, she had that leadership mindset at a young age. Definitely, if you ever had to take care of a sibling, you know what it's like. You're pretty much mom to them sometimes, at points of time. At 12 years old, Lisa stood 6 foot tall. Matter of fact, she had no exposure to basketball until she was in junior high school. So she picked up the game. It's not late, but junior high, I think that's like 8th grade, so 7th grade. Pretty much how she got into basketball, one of her classmates was like, hey, come to a basketball tryout, you know? Come hoop with, come, you 6 foot tall, girl, like, you don't talk to nobody. Come chill with us. Come try for the team, you know? Lisa did in hopes that, you know, just trying to make friends. She was like, whatever, I'm about to go make some friends. Hopefully make team, maybe not, maybe so, you know, not high hopes, not low hopes, you know. Well, she made the team, so she a left-handed basketball player, just touching basketball, making the team. Her first practice, the coaches, they divide the right hands from the left hands. And so she was the only left-hand player, and everybody else was right-handed. And so she was determined from that point to move with that right hand. Yeah, so pretty much, Lisa Leslie became ambidextrous. You can dribble with both hands, that's it. Like, you dribble with both hands, that's a Kyrie, a James Harden kind of move. Chris Paul, Z. Sorry, that's my dog, D. You want to be in the spotlight. Next. She started so late, who helped her work on her game? Well, her family did. Her cousin and her uncle was out there helping putting her in work, you know. Her uncle being one of the main ones telling her, like, you gotta be physical, you gotta be aggressive, you gotta push that, you know. You gotta bring that game. It's not just basketball, you know. It's a mental battle. So around her eighth grade year, she made the boys club. Boys club basketball team. That's the next level. You making a boys club basketball team, and you're a girl making a boys club basketball team. So you know you got skills. They initially refused. Don't get me wrong. They was like, nah, we not having it on this side. You know, we ain't being looked down upon by other teams. We got a girl on our team. You know how that pride. You know you got to put that pride aside sometimes, which they did once they seen her intercept a pass during the game and went off. Pretty much scored after the pass intercepted. After she did that, they was cheering, like, give the girl the ball, give her the ball, give her the ball. Like, they knew what the skill was at that point. Pride aside, it's all about winning. And that's what you need when you're trying to win. She began playing in the girls' Olympic development. I assume that's a league where they try to get you prepped for, you know, winning the women's Olympic team for real. And the thing is about getting on that Olympic team is that now, that development team, is that she's playing against girls way older than her now. So now she's playing against higher competition, playing with those higher groups, you know, that older group, and adjusting to their basketball. It's like a middle school kid training with the seniors who are in high school. This kid's in middle school playing with the high schoolers. What is the middle schoolers now when all he do is play with the high school team? He's gonna dominate the middle schoolers. He's gonna dominate them because he's playing with that older bunch. He's used to that kind of competition. Not my peers, not this week. And that's where she is. That's where she was. She was falling with women who were way older and surpassing her peers. That got her reach. That got her connection. Some unique connection. You got to know people to know people. And she made those kind of connections. She had 100 recruit letters from different colleges before she even reached high school. Speaking of high school, Lisa went on to go to Morganside High School, you know, in California. Her freshman year, she was named Freshman of the Year. Like, just like that. And this is where we enter the part of Lisa's life where this it makes you. And what I mean is that going into her sophomore year, she led her team to the state championship 1987-88. The game was tied, eyes on her. She gets the ball and she misses the game winning shot. Her team loses by one. Right then she vowed, like, we gonna be back. And here's the thing about Lisa. Since she vowed to lead her team to a state champion, she ended up rematching the same high school that she lost to freshman year in the state championship, Fremont High School. She played them and she tore them up. She got revenge, sweet revenge. This is probably one of the biggest rematches of history, to be honest. Fremont and Morganside with Lisa Leslie. Definitely if you're going back to back and you're seeing this same cat, that's some college kind of rivalry right there. USA Today and Parade Magazine actually named her like first team. The USA Today in Parade Magazine, I'm reading this right, named Lisa to their first team high school All-American squad that year. At 16, Lisa made the U.S. Junior National Team and traveled abroad for the first time to play in a World Championship tournament in Spain. At 16, she traveled in the world to go play basketball in a championship tournament in Spain. You know how big that is? Like, that's next level. She led the team. Lisa led the team in scoring, rebounding during the tournament. So she was dominating. She was dominant. She was the only high school player on that team. So she led the team in rebounding and scoring. And she's the only high school player on this team in this overseas country in Spain. You overseas. This is probably your first time ever overseas in a whole different country. And you leading your team. It's not affecting your game at all. You know what you came to do. You know what you came to do. You came to win. Let me tell you what her senior year was like. She set the record. Lisa set a national record by scoring 101 points in the first half of a game, going on to lead her team to a second consecutive state, and won the Naismith Award, given to the nation's top high school basketball player. Now, Lisa Leslie got hundreds of recruit letters, a bunch of different letters from a bunch of different colleges, but she decided to stay in California and go to the University of Southern California, USC. Pretty good college too, pretty good, great college. During her collegiate career, she led the team to an 89-31 overall record in four consecutive NCAA tournament appearances. Lisa played about a total of 120 college games, averaging 20 points, hitting 53.4% of her shots, and knocking down 69.8% of her free throws. She set the Pac-10 conference record for scoring, rebounding, block shots, accumulated points, 2,414 points, 1,214 rebounds, and 321 block shots. She dominated the college. Like, she dominated. She set records in college. In college, she was named a National All-Smith Freshman of the Year, 1994 Naismith College Player of the Year. Leslie also received the All-American Honors 1992, 1993, and 1994. Lisa became the first player to make first All-Conference team each of her 4 years. So every year, she made conference team. Every year. Lisa graduated from USC with a bachelor's degree in communications. So like other women who don't have college stars who graduated but didn't have a home as far as a league to play in, they went to Europe. They went and played for the European team. Lisa signed with a team in European Women's Professional League. She joined, I'm about to butcher these names, Siligueso, Sicilesso. Man, it's based in Alcamo, Italy. That's about as good as I'm gonna be able to say it. I'm sorry, I can't. She joined the team for the 1994-1995 season, where she gets offered to play a tryout for the Olympic team. And I probably didn't have to try out, probably just got picked. Because when you're doing what you're doing in a collegiate club, you're just getting chosen. Lisa, she made the 1996 Olympic team and helped lead the team to a gold medal. So now she's an Olympian. In the process, she set the record when she scored 35 points in one game. So after the Olympics, I assume that European life wasn't popping. I'm sure it wasn't like how living in America is. So she decided, I ain't going back. And so she decided to take up modeling. She worked with major fashion designers like Armani, Tommy Hilfiger, he does not hate black people, that's just a rumor, and Klein. When WNBA was established in the summer of 1997, Lisa, along with Cheryl Swoops and Rebecca Lobo, became the faces of the new league.
Welcome to the Great Western Forum and a festive atmosphere here in Los Angeles. It is a sellout and then some. They have had to open the upper decks to accommodate ticket demand here at the Forum and expecting a crowd of some 12,000 people. All of them here to witness the latest chapter in the history of women's sports, the debut of the WNBA. It's a marquee matchup between Leslie and Lobo as the two cornerstone franchises of the women's NBA square off here this afternoon in the debut.
Now, one thing about the WNBA and them starting just out of nowhere and picking up out of nowhere, they had to draft a lot of different players, you know, of different ages, like Cynthia Cooper, who started off her career very late with the WNBA because, well, the team wasn't around at the time. Like, there was no Houston Comets and no league, so they drafted different players. So these players were definitely leaving their primes or already in their primes, not 21-year-olds. And that includes Lisa Leslie. She started off her rookie year at the age of 24. Just wanted to come say what's up. Anyways, now when WNBA first started their league, pretty much there were two contenders. You had Houston, then you had everybody else, pretty much. Houston was a powerhouse. From 1997, pretty much all the way down to 2000, they were the force to be reckoned with. Fun fact, Lisa Leslie was one of the first basketball players, was the first WNBA basketball player to touch a basketball, to touch it. Start off tip ball, she's the first one to touch the ball. First game in history. That shit, that's pretty lit. The 1997 WNBA season, the league's first, opened with a game between the Sparks and the New York Liberty at the Sparks home at the time, the Forum, in Inglewood. You know what colors we representing. Inglewood, stand up. Let me stop before I get shot. The Sparks lost the game 57-67. The Sparks player, Penny Toler, scored the league's first 2 points. But, you know, we focused on Lisa. The Sparks had what many considered to be a disappointing season in 1997, finishing a record of 14-14. The team did not compete for a playoff spot, but because of the loss, Phoenix Mercury in the final game. At the end of that rookie season, Lisa Leslie ended up having 16 points, taking about 13 shots, pretty much making five. That's like 43%, that is, 43%. That was her rookie stat, 43%, averaging 16 points. And she had 9.5 rebounds. So she was definitely killing as far as board and pulling down. Wish we had more film in this, but they really be scrubbing WNBA film. Next season, they still didn't make the playoffs, pretty much. In 1998, the WNBA season, the Sparks finished 12-18, missing the playoffs once more. So, I mean, you know, it wasn't easy cookings out there. In 1999, season featured development of Lisa Leslie. So this is when they're saying Lisa Leslie became Lisa Leslie. They're saying it was 1999. The Sparks' first playoff berth, the first time they ever made the playoffs, as the Sparks posted a 20-12 record. 20-12, you know, going 14-14, then 12-18. Lisa said, nah, can't have this losing again, you know. Remember, in high school, she lost that first state champion and decided, like, leadership mindset is to win. So there was no way she was having three missed playoff seasons in a row. Had a 20-12 record. The Sparks won the first playoff game and the series win over the Sacramento Monarchs. They played a competitive Western Conference Finals but fell to the defending champion, Houston Comets, 2-1 in a 3-game series. And there it go, Cynthia Cooper. Cheryl Swoops, like, y'all out here making some noise out there in Houston, man. That, like I said, this is Lisa's video. In 2000, when you look back at the series, at the playoff series with the Comets and the Sparks, you can see that the Comets, they were just in a whole another league. Cynthia Cooper had 23 points and 12 assists. That was record breaking. I don't think the Sparks were built ready yet. They weren't ready to get over that hump yet, pretty much. The 2000 season was a record one, as the Sparks tore up the WNBA with a 28-4 record. 28-4. 28-4, like that, four losses, the best in league history, and second only to 1998 Comets, Houston Comets, for the best of all time. In the playoffs, the Sparks swept the Phoenix Mercury in the first round, but lost in the Western Conference Finals again when they were swept by the Comets. Ultimately, the Sparks were playing in the shadow of the Comets, and they won their first four WNBA championships. The 2001 offseason saw the move to the Staples Center and an important coaching change when the Sparks hired former Los Angeles player Michael Cooper as head coach. During the ensuing season, the Sparks again posted a 28-4 record. In the 2001 playoffs, the Sparks finally eliminated the Comets, sweeping them in the first round. The Sparks took all three games to eliminate the Monarchs to earn their first berth in the WNBA Finals, in which swept the Charlotte Stings 2-0 for the first league championship. They were all stepping stones to Lisa Light. They were all in her, obstacles in her way, teams in her way to reach the one goal that she wanted. Shoot, Seattle, they weren't even in the picture yet, but that's a different rivalry she'll have. Losing her hair, Australia, you know, that's a big time rivalry, winning gold, but it's nothing like winning that championship, that league championship in your league. Just saying that you're the best team, you're the best player. Finals MVP, she won Finals MVP. That's the best player in the league. Point blank, period. I don't care who the MVP is. If you're the Finals MVP, those are the best players right there that season. In 2002, Lisa became the first woman in league history to dunk the ball during a game. And once again, the Sparks dominated the regular season, posting a 25-7 record. The Sparks then flew through the playoffs, sweeping both Seattle Storm and the Utah Stars. In the finals, the Sparks were matched against the Liberty, who were looking for their first championship. A late three in game two by Nikki gave the Sparks their second consecutive championship. That three to end it, you know, that's us all day. Lisa won her second title. Her last title, but she has four gold medals. So, two titles, four gold medals. That's enough. That's enough gold for me. That'd be enough gold for me. Enough titles for me, you know. In 2003, the Sparks posted a 24-10 record and went into the playoffs looking for a three-peat. Both the first and the second rounds were forced to decide the third games as they beat the Minnesota Lynx and the Sacramento Monarchs. The Sparks then faced the upstart Detroit Shock in the finals. The Shock were on a roll after having been the worst team in the WNBA in 2002. The finals were a battle fueled by the relationship between head coaches Michael Cooper Sparks and Bill Laimbeer. Bill Laimbeer, let me give you background, played on the Detroit Pistons, one of the most aggressive, physical basketball teams to ever play in the NBA. Jordan hates Isaiah Thomas. To them, basketball, if we wouldn't win it, we fight. So any team Laimbeer coaches, I'm sure, has that same mentality, you know? The rough road to the finals and tough play of the Shock wore down the Sparks, which lost the series 2-1 and failed to three-peat. During the 2003 and 2004 offseason, the Sparks signed two standout players, Tamika Whitmore, Teresa Witherspoon, both of whom had played for the rival New York Liberty. When the season began, the Sparks got off to a great start, but Coach Cooper left at midseason to seek a coaching job in the NBA. Don't you just hate that, though? The loss of their coach was a factor in the team's so-so finish to the season, which ended with a record of 25-9. During the playoffs, the team stumbled, losing in three games to the Sacramento Monarchs. The Sparks stumbled and never recovered through the 2005 season and finished with a 17-17 record. They barely made the playoffs. They received number 4 seed in the first round. The Sparks were outplayed and swept by the eventual champion, Sacramento Monarchs. In 2006, the Sparks played much better, posting a 25-9 record in the playoffs. They defeated the Seattle Storm in three games. However, the Western Conference Finals, the Sparks season was ended by the Monarchs for the third year in a row. So the Sacramento Monarchs, I didn't remember your name, but I know your name now. After that, Lisa got pregnant. Nah, she didn't get pregnant. She was pregnant. And she had to take a break due to her pregnancy. You know, you want to take that season off. I forget what they call it. Y'all know what it is. But, you know, you get that little time off after you're pregnant or something. The loss of Leslie that year proved devastating, as the Sparks posted a league-worst 10-24 record. The record was also the worst in Sparks history, as the Sparks missed the playoffs for the first time since 1998. Before the start of the 2008 season, the team prospects improved dramatically. Lisa Leslie returned to the team. In April 2008, the team used its number one pick to draft Candace Parker, CP3. Don't even get me started. The College Player of the Year in 2008, the Sparks posted a 20-14 record and finished third in Western Conference. In the playoffs, the Sparks beat the Seattle Storm. See, that's that Lauren girl who played on Seattle Storm and pulled Lisa's hair in the Australian Olympics. See, we don't forget. They beat the Seattle Storm to reach the Western Conference Finals and compete against the San Antonio Silver Stars. The Sparks were on track to win Game 2 of the series, but the Silver Star Sophia Young made a turnaround bank shot with a second left on the clock to force the series to a deciding Game 3, and the Sparks lost Game 3 with the tie being on the Silver side. And the Silver Stars, they moved on to the WNBA Finals. You know, they weren't a mission. One shot cost you your run like that too. That's heartbreaking for real. I would have cried. I should have cried. When she said, never mind. Following in 2008, Parker announced she was pregnant. To compensate for Parker's absence, Sparks signed free agent Tina Thompson. The four-time WNBA champion, eight-time WNBA All-Star, also went to the same college as Lisa at USC. In 2009, this is the hard time, the Sparks, they started poorly. Candace Parker began the season on maternity leave, and Lisa Leslie suffered a knee injury early in the season. Both Lisa and Parker returned to the court in July, however, barking a 10-2 run, which turned a 8-14 start into an 8-16 regular season record, clinching the Sparks' 10th playoff appearance in their 13-year history. Damn. Lisa and Parker came back and that was it. You went from 8-14 to 18-16. In the first round of the playoffs, the Sparks defeated Seattle Storm for the third time in 4 years. In the Western Conference Finals, the Sparks lost to the eventual champion, Phoenix Mercury, in 3 games. The end of the 2009 playoff run marked the end of Lisa's career. A pure legend. She's like top 10 in points, top 5. Top 6 in rebounds, top 20 in steals. She is an accomplished legend. How good was Lisa Leslie? She's arguably the greatest of all time. LA Sparks all day. That being said, like, subscribe to me, what you like.